You're listening to the audio production of Strong and Kind and Other Important Character Traits Your Child Needs to Succeed by Korie Robertson with Chris Howard, featuring stories and wisdom by Willie Robertson, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Korie and Willie Robertson.
Pick two. What are two important character traits that you want to see in your children? I was sitting with a circle of women in a Bible study when this question was posed. I was a mom of two young toddlers, working part-time as a children's minister at our church, happily going to every study group I could find. Sometimes there was a sweet teenager there to watch the kids. If not, it was a good excuse to leave the kids to bond with their daddy for an hour or two while I enjoyed some much-needed adult conversation, uninterrupted by a child saying, "Mama," every 2.3 seconds. Willie and I were young, 23 and 21 years old, respectively, when we had our firstborn. I had just graduated from college, and Willie still had a few semesters to go. He had started college a semester after I did, having first gone to seminary and then working during our college years while I sped through, eager to start our family. When John Luke came along in October 1995, we couldn't have been more excited. What a gift. Willie and I, along with our families, absolutely adore babies. John Luke, the first grandchild on my side of the family, was passed up and down the church aisle every Sunday morning. Having been the oldest grandchild myself, I had lots of experience with little ones. I grew up babysitting my cousins, so I could certainly change diapers and rock a baby to sleep. Plus, I'm a reader, so I not only had experience, but I'd read lots of books. I was fully prepared to be a mom. Here's the lovely thing about youth. You don't know what you don't know. Being a young parent has its advantages. For one thing, you don't know what to worry about. You just do what you have to do. Willie and I had planned and dreamed about the sweet children God would give us. We had talked about how we were raised and how we planned to raise our babies. My family and Willie's family couldn't have looked more different on the outside. He lived on the river. I lived in a subdivision. He went to public school. I went to private school. He never played Little League or took a lesson of any kind. I took lessons in everything from piano to diving to baton twirling. His dad never came to one of his basketball games in junior high or high school. My parents were always on the sidelines, the VHS video recorder fully charged and ready to capture the moment. His mom is known for her cooking. My mom has the local pizza place on speed dial. While the methods they used in raising us were certainly far from the same, the values and character traits they instilled in us were from our mutual faith in God. So in that respect, our upbringings were the same. Even with that type of common ground, there are a lot of variations in how parents can raise their babies. Willie and I had a lot to figure out. We weren't really thinking of that at the time, though. We were young and in love and just excited to be having a baby. The most important thing for parents to decide. After being a parent for 20 years, I've come to believe that the most important thing for parents to decide, more important than bottle or breastfeeding, more important than co-sleeping or sleep training, and even more important than whether to put your child in daycare or become a stay-at-home parent, is what values are important to your family and how you will go about instilling those values in your children. My dad started a tradition that we continued on every family vacation during my growing up years. We would go through what he called our Howard Family Legacy of Principles for Living. I know, long title. My dad isn't known for his brevity. I'll admit, in the middle of riding the waves at the beach, hanging out with cousins, or making runs to the arcade at the neighboring hotel, we weren't always that excited about sitting down and going through a list of principles. But my dad always insisted, and for that, I'm now grateful. Our Howard Family Legacy of Principles for Living was a list of values that our family held dear and would strive to live by. At some point during every vacation, we would talk through each value we had previously listed and add to the list anything we had learned over the last year and deemed important enough to include. These values were based on the Bible and truths that we, as a family, wanted to keep in the forefront of our minds. Through the years, this list provided a compass for us whenever we forgot who we were and whose we were. It provided that little voice in our heads that reminded us of the kind of people we wanted to be. Check out this list in the appendix and consider starting one for your family. If you do it, make it your own. Call it whatever you want. Feel free to take one or two principles as a starting point and then ask your kids what values they believe are important for your family. This was a great way for our family to pass down a legacy of positive, healthy values, and it can be for yours too. What values do you hold dear? So back to the question posed to me in the Women's Bible Study. As you can see, the concept of considering values or character traits that are important and living by them wasn't new to me. But that night was the first time I remember actually trying to pinpoint the values I wanted for our children. What values did Willie and I hold dear? Not just what we had been taught from our families, but what was important for us, for our own little ones. As I said before, we were young and had in a few short years gone from learning these things from our parents to teaching, instilling, and living them in front of our kids. Our parents had not just talked about values that are important, but they also lived them, which I believe makes all the difference. My parents followed the principles we discussed on our family vacations. For Willie and me, life was good and peaceful. We knew that both our sets of parents were going to stick together through thick and thin, in sickness and health, and for richer or poorer. We had confidence that God was with us and that His Word was true and a good guide for living full and happy lives. We also knew that although our parents were not perfect, they would always strive to live God's way. Those were the things I wanted for my children then, and although much has changed in our life since I was a young mom sitting in that Bible study, those are the same things I still want for my children now. I remember clearly my answer from that night. I hadn't put it into words before then, but I knew immediately that my answer was strong and kind. These were the first two words that came to my mind then, and they are still my answer today. These are the two traits I thought our kids would need to survive in this tough, beautiful world, to maneuver through difficult times and to be the light God called them to be. If our children grew up to be strong and kind adults, I figured we would have been successful in our role as parents. But why strong and kind? The value of being strong. Being strong is essential to me because we know that life in this world is not always easy. Our kids will have people they thought were friends turn on them. They will have loved ones move away or die. They will have times when they won't make the cheerleading squad or their first love will break their heart. As they get older, their marriages will go through tough times. The person they love the most will let them down. They may have to deal with miscarriages, job losses, and cancer. Our children are not immune to the problems that make our time in this fallen world so difficult. They need to be strong to get through these times. Since we know our children will experience these kinds of difficulties, we want to prepare them, to help them become strong enough to handle whatever comes their way. Our strength doesn't come from us, but from the one living in us. The Bible tells us to be strong in Him and in His mighty power, Ephesians 6:10. We want our children to have the confidence that comes from knowing that when God is for them, no one can be against them, Romans 8:31. We want them to know that even though tough times will come, there will be good on the other side. They need to know that with God, they'll be strong enough to ride out the storm. We want our children to be resilient, so if these storms of life bend them, they will not break, and they will always come back to their faith and their Father in heaven. We want our children to be strong so they won't be swayed by others' opinions of them or easily influenced by peer pressure, social media, or entertainment. We want them to be secure in what they know about themselves and confident that God's way is the best way, no matter what the outside influences are saying. We want them to be able to hold firmly to God's values and truth, even in the midst of voices telling them differently. The Bible is full of words that encourage us to be strong. One of my favorites is, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Joshua 1:9. Strong. It was the first trait that came to mind that day. The value of being kind. My other word was kind. This trait is for the benefit of others. Kindness is in direct opposition to concern for oneself. Being kind is all about being thoughtful, noticing another's need, and feeling it. To be kind is to be loving and gentle with others, even when they don't deserve it. It's showing compassion to the hurting and encouraging others' successes. It's using good manners and showing respect for others' thoughts and opinions that differ from yours. It's living a life that is peaceful and joyful. God is love, 1 John 4:8, and the Bible tells us that love is patient and kind, 1 Corinthians 13:4. Our desire is for our children to treat others with kindness, no matter their race, social standing, popularity in school, or religious background. We never know what hard times a person has had or is going through and how valuable a kind word would be to that person. Since God is love and love is kind, we want our children to be kind. We want them to make this world a better place, to always leave a place or a person better than they found it. The Bible tells us that caring for widows and orphans is an act of true religion. See James 1:27. We're told that when we feed the hungry or clothe the needy, we're feeding and clothing Jesus himself, Matthew 25:40. Can you imagine how much better the world would be if people decided to be kinder to one another, to give others the benefit of the doubt, to respond when they see a need, and to offer a kind word rather than responding in the short, rude manner we use too often when we talk with one another when things aren't going our way. Willie and I want our children to have servants' hearts, to love others as they love themselves, and to believe that love and kindness can change the world. That's why I chose kindness as a second trait for our children. After voicing my desire to instill these two traits in our children, I took my request to God. I started praying that Willie and I would be able to teach our children these things, that we would raise strong, kind kids who would become strong, kind adults. God spoke to me very clearly. He said, "Then live it." So I started praying that Willie and I would be the traits we wanted for our children, that we would live them and model them so that our kids wouldn't just hear empty words from us, but would see the fruit of these character traits in our lives. On what character traits do you want to focus? This is not a book to tell you how to parent your children. Willie and I certainly are not perfect parents, nor do I believe there is a perfect way to parent your child. Families come in all different shapes and sizes, as evidenced by Willie's family and mine. God made each of us to be unique. Aren't we thankful for that? I'm one who appreciates differences. I love people with strong opinions, quirky habits, and interesting ways of living. God imprinted in our DNA and impressed on our hearts things that make each of us special. No one else in the world is quite like you as a parent or quite like your children. That's what makes the world go round. This is a book to help you answer this question. What two character traits do you want to focus on and instill in your children? Think about what's important to you. What has God placed on your heart? What principles guide you? What have your own life experiences taught you that your children will need to make it through theirs? I pray that you will have the confidence to be the unique mom or dad God created you to be to parent your one-of-a-kind child, and that there's a little bit of truth somewhere in this book that helps you on your journey.
Willie's words on our two traits. When I think about being strong and kind, I realize that, like Korie, I grew up seeing and being taught those traits by my own parents. However, I saw them in a different way than she saw them. When you grow up with three brothers in a two-bedroom house on the river and little money, the characteristic of being strong develops pretty naturally. In fact, it's a necessity. I also saw strong role models in my parents and grandparents who had strong personalities and knew the value of hard work. We were taught that no one owes you anything, you're not entitled, and there would be no sympathy for you if you're weak. Yes, four boys in the house meant that there was plenty of knocking around going on, so you had better toughen up and get strong. Growing up, my dad was the epitome of strength. Not only was he physically strong, having played Division I football in college and running hundreds of hoop nets to catch a fish for a living, but he was and still is very strong in his beliefs and his passions. He wasn't the only one in the family with strong passions. I heard many debates between relatives and friends that got very loud as each person stood their ground on an issue. No one in our family considered these fights mean-spirited, and no one was uncomfortable. We just saw them as being strong in what you believed in. If you discovered you were wrong, it was acceptable to change your mind because somebody had made a better argument. I learned to be strong and not be wishy-washy. If you're wrong, change. If you're right, help others see it your way. Now, I admit, with all those strong personalities, it was hard to see where kindness fit in, but it did. Everyone in my family would give anyone else a shirt, a meal, or money if they needed it. Nearly every day of my life, I watched my parents open their door to complete strangers. And because we lived in the woods a good ways out of town, we were also the recipients of kindness. If one of us was sick or needed anything, the people in our church and community would come to help us. These qualities helped me in all areas of life today. For me, running a company, especially with most of my family on the payroll, demands both strength and kindness. I have to stay strong in making decisions that are best for our company, and I have to be strong to withstand the worries that come with owning a business. But I also need to be kind. Otherwise, no one will want to work for me. There have been times when I've taken grown men to the mall and bought them new clothes in sort of a redneck makeover. I've arranged transportation to help others to get to work, help people get a date, can you say Duck Commander dating service, or simply work with them to boost their confidence. I've never been a fan of people being mistreated in any way. Korie and I work together every day. This can be a challenge because when you're in the workplace together and then go home together, it can really test your kindness. We like to use our strength to treat each other with kindness. We've seen some great...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.